this is a good recording, man.
Yeah, brother,
I can dig it.
Stop. Right on.
Hey, man, what's your name?
I think anyone who puckers up their lips and presses it against their boss's buttocks and then smooches is an ass kisser.
I seem to be inept at everything except my work. I'm good at my work. So I confine myself to that. All I want out of life is a 30 share and a 20 rating.
The man's enlarged my mind. He's a poet, warrior in the classic sense. I'm a little man. He's a great man.
Think of it as colors. There's black and there's white. And in between is mostly gray. That's us. Now, gray is a tough color because it's not as simple as black and white. And for the media, certainly not as interesting. But it's who we are.
Okay.
And KFAN.com. 2 minutes and 45 seconds. No, 52 seconds past the hour, 3 o'clock. Central Standard Time. Welcome back. Friday edition, Bumper to Bumper show. And I apologize for being late.
I was worried about you.
I didn't mean to pull an Anthony Edwards, but I lost myself in the pregame prep.
Really?
And I think what really caused me to lose track of the time, a la Anthony Edwards, the news that might change everything. What's the most pressing issue facing Minnesota sports fans right now? It's the Cousins conundrum. What's going to happen with number 8? Is it possible? We got the answer to that question today with the news that your favorite tight end, John Mundt, has agreed to a contract extension or a new contract, I don't know, maybe both, to return to the nest and the Minnesota Vikings.
Could that, the stories a stadium could tell.
If can the Falcons match that?
If they're doing the ledger?
Is it a ledger? If it's a chess match, is that checkmate for the Minnesota Vikings? Where Cousins goes, you know, I really was going to go, but they're bringing Mundt back. They're hedging their bets because they know TJ might not be ready for the start of the season, but they're saying, we got your back. We are signing or bringing back John Mundt, who I thought was underutilized. I view Johnny Mundt as kind of the Luka Garza of the Minnesota Vikings.
It's an untapped resource.
There's no question.
It's an untapped resource. And no coincidence that they're doing it. Mm-hmm. What, 70 hours before legal tampering? Maybe less, 50?
Good luck on the math for you.
Yeah, I have no idea. Yeah. 48 hours and change, because it's 2 days away and change, basically, from Monday. That they're just dropping this in as he's getting ready for a nice, calm weekend, I assume, in Michigan. And here comes the Mundt news for him to stew over for the next 36 to 48 hours. Need to turn your mic on.
So that, I'm not going to lie to you. I'm thinking that through, and I literally say, what time is it? And I grab my phone, and it says 3 o'clock.
Time to go.
And then I sprinted, headed your direction at that particular juncture. So if you, I know we've got some Munt fans. If you're a Muntobos, that doesn't really sound very good. Muntiacs, what would... what would it be for our John Munt fans that are out there?
I'm going to have to think about it for
a minute. Chances are TJ's not going to be ready for the start, right? We don't think.
Correct.
There's at least that possibility.
I wouldn't think he would be. That's what Seifert kind of keeps hinting at when he's in, that they don't think he's going to be ready. Gessling might know. He's going to join today at 4:30, so he might be able to tell you.
And Lavelle will join on the Abort and Volvo guest lineup at 5:30 from spring training. Is that correct?
He will be in spring training, won't he?
Yeah.
He's down there.
Is that his time?
Yes.
So,
and semifinal preview with Luigi, because it's Friday nights.
Oh, I forgot about Louie. That's right. I didn't even put him on the list.
Never. I mean, this is the last year we can do it.
Yeah, during the tournament. You're right.
During the tournament, the last Friday night. Remember when he had
we could have him on during the tournament, but he would just be in a more unofficial capacity.
Will he even be watching in Florida?
That's a great question. I
probably
mean, do you have access to it in Florida?
Well, he would, because he's got, the sling box.
Does he know how?
He's got all that. Yeah, he watches everything.
He does have the sling box still?
Something like that.
Yeah.
Remember when he made all Muntheads. Of Duluth mad?
Muntheads.
Munthead is as good.
Muntkins, as in Munchkins?
Munchkins.
Munthusiasts?
Munsters.
Yeah, that could be it. Anyway, you were saying?
When Louis made the entire city of Duluth, including the mayor, mad when he said that Duluth East had no chance to beat Edina on that one semifinal night, and then they did.
That's right.
Because that's what Duluth East did with Coach Mike Randolph,
that's
who's
right.
now at St. Thomas.
Yeah.
They muddy it up and they make it difficult on the
Louis
Hornets.
Never lived that down.
He never did. Well, and I just thought it was funny. I mean, the mayor was tweeting at him.
Yeah, there was a lot of bitterness.
But the fatal flaw in the logic was Louis was getting that information from the Duluth East coach, who basically told him that day, I don't think we have a chance tonight. Like, it's going to all have to go perfectly.
It was one of those, I think, classic examples of being mad at something not worth getting mad at all. But
yes.
Ever since. In fact, when I had Louis on yesterday, I asked him whether Edina should be viewed as like a big favorite. And I think he was loath to even suggest they might be a favorite.
Yeah.
And I think that's part of it. He always feels like, oh, you always pick Edina.
6-1-2 Lou.
Yeah, 6-1-2 Lou. And yep. So I think he's reached a point now where it's gotten into his head whether he realizes it or not. So he's going to join us around 5?
That's the plan, yeah. I know
change.
Yesterday there was an audible while I was gone. I'm hoping it'll be around 5. I'll confirm it with him here in a little bit. But right before he goes on TV. If I can get Halvey to set it up for us. Halvey's mad at me, so I might have to soften that blow.
We'll get to that a little later. The Halvey's night last night, which apparently got a little bit pear-shaped because of the results involving his favorite high school hockey program. But are you aware of why Lavelle is going to be totally and completely boxed when he joins us at 5:30?
I'm assuming it's going to be Twins payroll related.
Yeah, and it's because he wrote that ridiculous piece before he got there defending the indefensible. And yet, his first column from Florida, what was the theme? Do you remember it?
I don't.
The theme was, he told us his plan was, all right, I got like 5 questions.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to try to get each of those 5 concerns, 5 things I'm wondering about. And his first concern and question was, is there enough starting pitching at the top of the rotation? And guess what his conclusion is? There isn't.
No.
So we're back to him being utterly and completely boxed in. Because if he believes that, then he shouldn't be mad at Twins fans for having basically noticed the same thing, which is why they're more bugged about the slashing of the payroll. How can you have it both ways? So we'll find out if he's going to... He'll try to wiggle out of it, but I don't think he's going to be very effective. I wonder if he even realizes the degree to which he boxed himself in. We'll find out, and hopefully he won't cough too much. Didn't he have another coughing jag last week?
It was something like that, yeah. And I would also say, if thinking Ankow is listening, don't text him
don't
give him the warning.
Because he's not, he listens a lot, but he's not listening right now.
No.
So, yeah, don't give him that warning. I probably shouldn't have said anything.
Yeah, that's what happens. Because I'll get a text now in like an hour. It says, why am I getting ripped?
Why am I getting ripped?
And they'll say, what do you mean? He'll say, Think It Ain't Gal says I'm getting ripped. And I'll say, I don't remember. That was an hour ago. We've moved on to other things. And then you'll rip him at 5:30.
You have I think some math work to do.
Well, yeah, we know that. That's
where did it go?
That's no. I'm never disputing that.
Somebody said, "Well, you did you mention 48 hours or 70? That 48 hours would be Sunday at 3 o'clock."
Yeah, I said 48 plus. I mean, I was just rounding to get to Monday when the legal tampering. Well,
why not go to 72?
We could. I mean, I did that too. I kind of covered all the bases.
Oh,
yeah.
You went 48 to 72?
Yeah, I kind of just said this is something to think about for the next 48 to 72 hours.
Oh, okay. I thought you just said 48 because he's
I think I had a 50 thrown in there. I was aware I wasn't going to get perfectly done with the math.
Here's what's interesting to me. The Jackals have gone relatively silent on this story. What do we make of that? You know, we had that rush of endless speculation for like 2 to 3 days.
Yeah.
And now it's like the calm before the storm, I guess. But I keep waiting for another shoe to drop because nothing obviously can be official yet. But I'm kind of is it the Jackals are biding their time? Is that should the relative silence after all that Atlanta momentum mean that the chances of the Vikings keeping him are improving? Are they having some kind of a come to Jesus moment in the front office to say, you know, that number we said we couldn't get to? Screw it.
We need it.
We're going to have to get to it, even though we could have done this a lot cheaper if we'd have just followed through with it last year. But last year's gone, right?
It's over. Well, what did I say on TV tonight? Which is interesting to ask because it hasn't aired yet. But what do I say on TV tonight? There's almost a little bit too much Atlanta steam for me earlier in the week. It got too hot. It got too hot too quickly
for me.
Well,
yeah, but by that logic, it's not any hot. Not hot. It's hot now, so that could mean it is going to happen.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Or everything's gone cold.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Or maybe there's another team lurking.
Could be. I rule nothing
Denver
out with
just
Cousins.
Got rid of a bunch of money.
They did.
I still find it hard to believe they could financially pull this off. And again, I'll say again. Maybe we got a big Bronco expert out there. Explain to me how the general manager is still the general manager there. In all seriousness.
It's crazy.
How? Nothing against George Payton, by the way. By all accounts, as a sweetheart of a guy, a great guy. How does he still have a job? What does he know?
I don't know.
And when did he know it?
And what's the plan now?
Man.
Do you give him credit?
Why do you trust him any plan?
Do you get credit because he got Sean Payton, your guy? That he convinced Sean Payton to come be the coach
there?
That
didn't work very well year one.
But that was because of the bad quarterback, allegedly.
Well, yeah.
So we'll see. But you got to give him credit for that, I guess. It's a pretty hot coach. Got him out of retirement.
Billick says, and a lot of people were bitter, you might be too, don't sleep on, I tell you what, I'll name you the quarterback that he said don't sleep on when we come back. How's that for a tease?
I like that tease. I'll be here.
He definitely had some interesting things to say about this particular QB. The bad news is, though, it seems like he's already on his way going someplace else. Or good news, if you hate him, which I know some in our audience, including Ben Lieber, definitely does. We will get to a done-as item next segment. And we'll cover a couple of other items that have remained stuck in my craw. One of them brought to my attention by frequent bumper-to-bumper contributor, Robert Smith. By the way, for the record, did you see what Dan Winnesota posted on this date? And it foreshadowed calamity. At the time, it was celebrated on the same day that actually something else calamitous took place. What the hell am I talking about? On this date, Dan Winnesota writes in Minnesota Sports History, 2005, Vikings head coach Mike Tice first meets with NFL officials about selling Super Bowl tickets.
Yeah.
Tice denies any wrongdoing and even offers to take a lie detector test. I didn't remember that. Did you?
No.
Did he take it and flunk it? Because he got nailed. Didn't he eventually confess?
He was fined $100,000,
I think. Maybe he never did confess. But I thought he kind of owned up to it.
Yeah. No, he did. And he's made cheap shots about it on his own
accord. Exactly. Well, smartly, eventually he figured out that was the best way to stop other people from going there. You go there, you get there first. But on the same day, Dan Winnesota reminds us that Tice was first questioned about selling Super Bowl tickets, and by the way, collecting tickets from players so that then they would make something like maybe $1,000 a ticket, which is good money. But again, you think, is that going to catch the eye of a wealthy football player? Certainly wouldn't be it wouldn't catch you have a wealthy basketball or baseball player. Football, maybe it's still more blue collar. I don't know. It sounds like chicken feed by those standards. Anyway, same day, Vikings signed Fred Smoot, whose party planning would eventually sink Tice's ship as Winnesota says his coach.
That's good rip.
Very good well writing. Played. Very very good writing and very, very true. So it was the Tice part was already calamitous. Smoot was celebrated. He was going to be, by the way, a weekly contributor to the Bumper to Bumper show. That lasted, I think, like 2.5 weeks. And then ultimately, Smoot was not very successful here other than getting Tice in trouble. Love Boat, largely his inspiration, correct?
That is his legacy above all else. Because he wasn't a bad cornerback. He was a pretty good corner. Here, I don't think he was great.
No.
But he was good enough to, I think, get the contract that he deserved. People liked him. Funny guy to be around. Funny guest, entertaining, when
entertaining,
you could get him.
But he was not as good as advertised here, and it just went badly. Wasn't he affiliated with assorted sex toys on the Love Boat? Wasn't that part of his
emphasis on the Z of toys?
Yes.
Plural.
Yeah.
Very, very plural.
That's what I thought.
His hands were full.
And I can't remember how that got revealed or uncovered, but it was, I mean, those were different times, man. I can't call them innocent times, but they were different. It's hard to believe. You look back on that and you go, my God.
I was telling the story. Somebody brought up the Mawelde Moore thing the other day about sex. Mm-hmm. I'm engaged. And I was to the right shoulder of Mawelde Moore. So I was right to his right. When he said that in the scrum, because
you were okay.
I used to go cover the locker room, like that was part of my job, whatever it was. And I was working here. I wasn't an intern, but you know, when we'd fill in and do stuff, I was in charge of the locker room. And so I was standing right next to Mawelde Moore when he uttered that. And it's just one of those things where you just around and you can't even believe it happened.
We had it here for years. I don't know if we still do. It was a soundbite that got played early and got played often. I don't know if
I didn't see any sex, man. I'm engaged.
That's it. I'm engaged.
I wonder if he's still married.
Very good question.
I hope he got married.
No, it's 50-50, according to the stats.
Yeah. I mean, we're talking.
So I'm not here to judge. I don't think
19 years ago, right? That was 2005.
Yeah, 2005. So next year will be 20, the big 20-year anniversary. It'll be a big, much bigger production.
Or an anniversary show.
Even year anniversary show. Okay. So when we last left for Minnesota Timberwolves, they were done. It was over. Cat was going to get go under the knife. I think it's scheduled for early next week. Or next week was the last I heard. Most of you know by now it's supposed to be, okay, then after 4 weeks, we will reevaluate, which puts you right up against the play-in and the end of the season, which would seemingly keep the door somewhat ajar to the possibility of him returning. There's a million variables there, not the least of which, even if he is deemed healthy enough and recovered enough to come back, how will he play? I'm sure the Wolves would like to take their chances on that. The most important thing is that the surgery be, quote-unquote, successful, and that the rehab go according to plan as well. And then you then give yourself the best chance to say, yeah, we think we can get something out of him, and we think he can help us make a bit of a run during the playoffs as well. Then the Wolves took to the road to take on the Pacers last night. One of the most explosive offensive teams in basketball. And this was a sort of a perfect example of why the Minnesota Timberwolves didn't at least publicly lose their minds when Edwards did something that almost no player that I can recall ever did what he did. Forget that it was game time, apparently within the arena the other night. And two, that he's apparently not all that interested in taking part in home pregame player introductions, because when you can do the sorts of marvelous things, borderline absurd things that he did in Indianapolis, Indiana last night at the old Conseco, you shake your head and say, yeah, what do you want me to do about it? What do you want me to do about a couple things that kind of bug me about the way he goes about his business? That was, I think, I will submit, I would argue, the best game he's played in a Minnesota Timberwolves uniform. The numbers are part of it. He ended up with, 44 points?
44, yep. 16 in the fourth quarter, I think.
That's correct.
Final 8 minutes.
And more remarkably, despite, I think he played 38 or 39 minutes.
39.
Did not have a turnover. And, of course, that's been part of the rub, is because the ball's in his hands as much as it is, and it was on in his hands even more, that he gives it up too much. There were zero turnovers. There were, as his head coach said, there was decisiveness once he got the ball. He didn't paw at it so much. He didn't hold on to it so much. He made quicker decisions, and that tends to work better for almost any player, quite frankly. He got to the basket. He slashed. He took mid-range. He hit shots outside. He scored the Wolves' last 8 points. And then, of course, he finished it with what I suggest is as good an end-of-game block as you'll see from any player at any size. Now, there have been blocks more impressive because of more was on the line in the postseason, the famous LeBron block. There have been several like that. But there's no better block that you'll see from a guard who handled it perfectly. He was doing a little bit of lurking, but he had the play measured. And the pacer, forgive me if I do not remember his name, he was not in his vision. He thought, if I can get past...
Nesmith, right?
Correct. Yeah. Well, thank you. If I can get past Conley, which I'm too tall for him, and I'm going to get over him, then I'm fine. And he did get past Conley, and Conley wanted to make sure he didn't foul. And so at that point, you're not going to lose the game on that play. It's going to be a tie game. You're going to go to OT. And Edwards is biding his time, measuring, and then he soared. And as most people know by now, hit his head on the backboard, et cetera, et cetera. An absolutely absurd combination. And I want you to, do you have access to the Athletic website?
Yeah.
Will you get on athletic.com, theathletic.com? Get to the Timberwolves, click on the Timberwolves link, because what you need here is the headline on the Johnny Athletic game story from last night.
The awe-inspiring block injects new life into Timberwolves.
Now, is there a photo underneath the headline?
There is a photo above with the Sam Cassell.
That's what I wanted to ask you.
Yeah.
I did not notice any remote resemblance to the big balls dance of Sam Cassell fame, and it looks to me like in that still shot at least, it is absolutely Anthony Edwards.
It does appear that way.
Out Casselling Cassell in the big balls dance. You know why? Edwards' hands kind of cupped together are almost on the ground. The suggestion I got out of it was, you think Sam Cassell had big balls.
Right.
Check out the big balls on me. Now, am I reading too much into that photo?
You might be, because given that Ann had no idea who Alex Rodriguez was, I doubt he's locked in on Wolves history with Cassell.
I want to believe it.
But it would be, we can, I think, attach to it.
Well, but...
And on the week that Jason Kelsey was talking about big balls, it's only fitting that it comes up later in the week. It's been a big balls week around here.
It has been. So, but is it possible, even without knowing the Sam Cassell part, is that what he's attempting to show, demonstrate in said photo?
I think it is.
Because I don't remember seeing it in the video.
Me neither.
When I just in real time as I'm watching the game, or even the video that's shown on highlights, I don't remember him doing that.
No.
So I'm trying to figure out if it's just misleading, because the moment of that still shot, that's where his hands happened to be, but his hands he didn't really mean to convey the signal that I'm assuming he did.
I think he did.
Okay.
Because there's only one reason to have your hands there like that. There's only
maybe
one.
Maybe you're kind of just stretching your arms out. You're kind of tense or something, or a little tight.
Maybe, because he did say his wrist hurt. He had some ice on it, but like anything.
Wrist and his head.
I mean, there was a million things. Just how he fell. I mean, how high would he have gotten if the rim wasn't there? Because he exploded into the rim.
Oh, it was unbelievable. It was like I said, it was just absolutely. I mean, again, there's nobody. There is nobody, including Kevin Garnett, who can have that sort of dominance in the last minute and 11 of a basketball game. It can't happen. That is how, and again, he's young. He's been in the league now. This is his fourth year, I think. So he's not a teenager. But the fact that he's not even supposed to be close to, I mean, when did Jordan reach his prime? 27, 28?
Probably.
In that range? That's the part that's so mind-boggling. The question is, can we convince him to show up every night on time?
Join Meat Sauce and Miller Lite next Tuesday, March 12th, Little Village Pub in White Bear Lake from 5 to 7 p.m. You can stop by and register for your chance to win a spot in the Vikings Foundation Golf Tournament. Plus, stock up on Miller Lite Golf Swag. It's all at KFAN.com, keyword golf, for more info.
310 texter is suggesting that Edwards might have stolen a block from Jaden McDaniels because he was going up as well. Is that true? Did you note?
Jaden was right there. He basically had to jump over Jaden, get to the ball.
You think Jaden's bitter that he took his moment away from him?
In the picture where Edwards is doing the Cassell, it doesn't look like it. Looks like he's happy.
Well, you named the driver for
Aaron
the Pacers.
Nesmith.
He did look dazed afterwards. I mean, he did sort of look like, what the hell just happened there? Now, a couple people said, that's a foul. I don't think it was, although I've seen that play called as a foul before. Down low body contact.
Yep.
I'd like to think it was a non-call. Somebody is texting also that Bayless suggested.
Don't do this.
That it was one of the easiest blocks he's ever seen.
Let's not give oxygen to stupidity.
Which doesn't make a lot of sense to me, but that's okay.
This is the end.
This is from bringmethenews.com. A lot of people have covered this. The father of Duluth Marshall's Chloe Johnson speaking out after the Crosby-Ironton High School student section reportedly chanted OCD at the eighth grader during Wednesday's game. Incident comes 2 months after Johnson, through Chip Scoggins, went public with her struggles with obsessive compulsive disorder and other mental health conditions, becoming an advocate for those facing similar battles. Post by some of those who are watching Duluth Marshall's loss at Crosby Ironton reported chants directed at Johnson, 14, each time she had the ball or made a mistake on the court. Her father, Greg, went to social media after the game. Obviously not the outcome we were hoping for, which brings its own set of emotions, but to end the season with the Crosby Ironton fan section chanting OCD, OCD when Chloe had the ball was not something we were prepared for. Seriously? We're really... I guess there's a part of me that says we shouldn't be surprised that there are idiot kids capable of this.
Mm-hmm.
Do we know how widespread it was? Is it like literally one goofball thinking he's being funny? Or was it... If there's a chant, it sounds like it would be more than one that was involved in it, correct?
Yeah, I mean, I haven't seen any video of it, but people are kind of talking about that. I know Crosby has addressed it. I think Janice Shortall talked to him.
Well, you know, it's funny you bring that up because I'm looking at a reaction story from Crosby Ironton school officials. This is from nprnews.org, and they quote the superintendent of the... school. So the school district investigated the incident, took appropriate action against a handful of students who were involved. Data practices laws limit what that individual could disclose. They've just said it's disciplinary action against some students, which is indeed good. We've got great kids here. We'll stand by our kids every time. If we have a kid or two or three or a handful that have made a mistake, we're going to take care of that, and we're going to make sure that they correct that mistake and that they learn from it. This might not be doable. This might not even be anything that Chloe is interested in participating in. But the ultimate for me would be when you're talking about administrators, you get those kids. If you have, you know, however many you got, if you got three, if you got six, or you got nine, and you find a way to require that they sit down with Chloe and they look Chloe in the eye. And they give Chloe a chance to deal with it as well in that way. But only if, obviously, she would want to be put in that position. That to me would be literally, we talk about teachable moments all the time. That's the teachable moment. Say, you want to say something to her now? What do you got to say?
Right.
And you know they're going to clam up.
Right.
There, and you'd hope that they'd say,
"We're sorry.
We're sorry that we did this." It's just pathetic. What's interesting about the NPR news story is they don't name Chloe in this story. They just refer to a Duluth Marshall player. Now, my assumption is they think, in their own way, they're protecting her because of her age. And yet, I'm not sure that's doing her anything but a disservice in this case, because she is already, for all good reasons, well known. And she, along with her parents, made that decision very consciously. That's something that Scoggins sat down and talked to them about and tried to explain to them, that you're kind of crossing the Rubicon here, and you have to understand, to a certain extent, what you've signed up for. Even something this bad, even something this indefensible and this sick, that chances are, if there wasn't that awareness through that story, there's not going to be a chant. Unfortunately, not for the right reasons, but because they don't necessarily associate anything with any particular player on the other team, correct?
Yeah, and I'm obviously on the punishments, there's got to be something. They got to deal with it. I when I read that this morning, the first thing I thought of is, what are the adults doing there?
Right.
What is the other coach doing there? What's the Crosby coach doing? What's the Crosby administrators doing? Because there's a lot of people at these games. These are section games. There's a lot, and these are two really good teams. You know, Crosby Ironton's really good. They've got a great player as well. And obviously, everybody knows who Chloe is. I can't imagine being in that gym as an adult and letting that go on. That's what I'm trying to figure out. Is,
well, the answer to that question, it's a good one, is how, you know, was it literally the way it's described, and this has happened at the end of the game. So was it one time she had the ball? Was it 10 sure. times she had the ball? How loud was it? How obvious was it? Because there's a number of variables. And in fact, we've had a couple stories, if you recall, where there were really significant accusations thrown out and other people
That's right.
flat out
denied them.
They could, well, not only did they deny them, video indicated that there was no indication of them. Now, I don't think anybody, though, is running from it here. It sounds like, at least after the fact, administrators are trying to deal with it. Whether they did as much as they could at the time is a very fair question. That should be part of the discussion. And I don't know, has the coach for Crosby Ironton spoken up on this? I haven't seen every story on it, or written or read every story.
Nor have I.
But it's pathetic. It's absolutely shameful. You could say not necessarily surprising. And kids do stupid things.
They do.
Doesn't mean they have to go away forever.
No, no. Kids are stupid.
There absolutely needs to be. And I don't know. I guess maybe I live in a la-la land, because I did think enough progress has been made. Even with the original reaction to the story that Scoggins wrote, frankly, a kind of story that ain't going to be written 20 years ago or 30 years ago or talked about. In fact, it would almost be like, well, we're too embarrassed for
sure.
the kid. We're not going to talk about this condition. This almost like as if she has something to hide that she should run from. I was naive enough to think we've made enough progress in that regard that, okay, it's one goofball thinking he's being really cute. Notice I'm saying he. That's probably unfair. I don't want to be sexist, but that's what my gut probably tells me. It's one of those head shakers and very, very sad. LOL, what a boomer take, writes 320 guy. Those kids would laugh in your face before going in and talking with Chloe to apologize. No, you don't understand, 320 guy. The kids wouldn't have a choice. They could laugh all they want. And by the way, if they would laugh in your face, then there'd be further punishment, right? This isn't rocket science. This isn't difficult. Talk to any principal, any dean of discipline worth his or her salt. And guess what? I'll wait till you're done laughing and you're still going to talk to her. And if you choose at that point to double down on what you've done, that's cool. But there will be a further punishment. So what is a boomer? What does boomer have to do with this story? He goes on to write, I've got mental issues and this isn't as bad as you're making it. I have to accept your opinion or feeling on this subject because you've got mental issues. So you're more qualified to discuss what is proper and whether this is serious or is not serious. No, it's again, no kids have to be put away forever or even, I don't think, kicked out of school. But I do think it is important, and we've talked about this on so many different issues in schools, for principals to not hide behind the lawyers and to attempt to make strong statements. And maybe a couple of these kids are such losers and so ill-equipped or don't have the kind of guidance in their lives to understand the significance of what they're doing and why they shouldn't do it, that they're going to be lost causes. But I don't care. They can laugh all they want. I mean, I guess it's ironic that someone who claims he has mental issues would be this laissez-faire about this level of cruelty. Now, we've talked before about being patronizing and almost trying to protect kids too much to the point where they don't even want the protection, the notion that they're going to go to pieces. I don't care how Chloe responded, quite frankly. To me, if I'm the administrator, do you care? I don't care. No. I'm going to do what I got to do. This is my school.
What's your school
stand
for?
This is our situation. We're supposed to be the parent, like you said, the parents in the room or the adults in the room. So, yeah, you can laugh your ass off all you'd like. I some of the best deans of discipline will gladly tell you. You can laugh all you want. That doesn't mean the notion laid out here is, well, why even bother talking to them? Because they're just going to laugh it off. So
you let it go?
What kind of message are you sending in that regard? No message you send is going to eliminate this. We get that. That's not even to me the point. The point is you do what you can because part of your job as an adult is to hold children accountable for their behavior and to attempt potentially to get through to them. And is it unreasonable to think that one of the ways you might demystify this or take some of the humor out is to have to look the other person in the eye, right? As opposed to, because otherwise it's she's an entity, right? You don't even, these kids, I'm sure, don't even think of her as a human being. They just, oh, that's the one they wrote that article about.
Right.
There's no skin off my nose. It's almost like texting here where you got no skin in the game because you rarely identify yourself and you can say whatever you want. There's not going to be any consequences to it. So I guess I don't understand why this would turned into someone who's saying much ado about nothing. No big deal. Seriously? Don't even worry about it? Okay. Where's the other text I wanted to get to? If my daughter was either the one getting bullied or was on the other team, I would have spoken up as a parent in the moment. I don't stand for this crap. I'm a bigger guy. I've been called intimidating. I would never hurt someone, but would have spoken up in that moment. Very sorry to hear this. Well, what we've learned over the years is a lot of people are reluctant to get in, even if they in their mind are going, well, this is pathetic. They don't want to stand up. They don't. Some of it has to do with personality. Some of it has to do with group dynamics, whatever the case may be. It's unfortunate. But there are, you know, and I know there are a lot of people. Hell, there used to be a show. Is it still on ABC? John Quinones did the old "What Would You Do?" You know, they set up.
Yeah.
I thought rather melodramatically these sort of ethical moments where they set up somebody doing, you know, saying something to someone in a restaurant and treating them badly, and are you going to step in or you're not going to step in? It all felt a little artificial to me. But that's some of the the point here as well. Totally agree with the other guy. Having them talk to her would do nothing. They need to be publicly shamed. Get their names out. Why? This is another 320 guy. I didn't rule that out. I said among the things I'd like to see, because I think in my own experience, I assume in your experience, in most people's experience, if they end up having to get a little bit more, if it, whatever they've done with someone else is becomes more personal, where they have to sort of address that individual or talk to that individual, it does often chasten you, or it does make you think of it a little bit differently than you would. So when I said that as an idea, I didn't say that was all. I've said there's got to be, they've got to be disciplined regardless. On names, I don't even know. My guess is schools, you're back to the legalities mm-hmm. of how public schools can be.
Yep.
Mentioned in this NPR story that they said, well, because of the ages of the kids, we have limits to what we can say publicly about the way we've decided to hold people accountable. And that does open the door to, well, did you really? Right? You know, you can hide behind that because it's the law. You can hide behind that because maybe you're not really being as tough as you're sounding. That's part of the frustration in a situation like this.
Yeah, and again, I go back to on the kids' side of things. Like, does a kid necessarily need to be branded for the rest of his or her life because of something stupid that they chanted at a high school basketball game? I would say no. I always go back to the adults and the thing. I mean, I've told the stories before about, you know, when you know, even if it was like swearing or profanity, or you say something like, if we did that at a high school game, like I remember multiple situations where an administrator was right over there and saying, hey, this isn't the game to do that. This isn't the time to do that cheer.
Right.
Clean this up. Do this differently. Like, not like they had to come over every 5 minutes, but kids are going to cross the line and do stupid stuff. They just are. That's why there's adults there. And I'm not taking the kids off the hook for it, obviously. But to throw their names out there and make this all about them, I think misses the larger point of what else was going on in that gym with people that absolutely should know better, that are put in places there to make sure that stuff like this doesn't happen to anybody.
I think that there's a real issue with lack of empathy and teaching it in general throughout our system. Yeah, that's part of it. I mean, part of it, again, is I just think there's a problem with accountability and reluctance often. Here's the sad reality. Would there have been any punishment doled out, whatever it was, at all, if this story hadn't gone public? If the 14-year-old players, if Chloe's dad hadn't gone public,
right?
Then that goes back to what you'd asked earlier. What did the adults do at the time? Because there shouldn't really need to be. In fact, I would argue that if you're doing your job as an administrator, you're not even waiting for Chloe to go, or Chloe's dad to go public. You're on top of it.
You're handling it.
And you're handling it, because otherwise it potentially comes off as, oh God, we're in the meat grinder now. This kid's got major publicity, got a lot of attention, and we better cover our tracks here. We better talk tough. You'd like to think you'd on the front end say, again, depending on what you know when you know it. I mean, not every administrator could have been, maybe have heard it. Not every administrator might have even been there. But that you are not even waiting for anything to go public when this sort of, this sort of line is indeed crossed. You want to support, this is regarding the last texture, you want to support doxing juveniles? That's insane.
No, I don't
think either one of us is saying that at all. The issue here was his somehow being annoyed by what's supposed to be, I think, sort of discipline 101. If part of what you're trying to do is discipline and to educate, right? I mean, they're educators. So whether they publicly or outwardly laugh in your face or not, make them face it. And I guarantee you that was with many kids, the message will be conveyed. They may not want to admit it because they might be too proud. It might be, I'm not going to give you the credit to think that, wow, God, this is really embarrassing when you put me in this position. But that doesn't mean you don't do it. Where are these people coming from? I have absolutely no idea.
It looks like most of them the 320 area code that you've been reading.
That is interesting. But I last thing we want to do is stereotype an entire area code. Or do we? Huh.
No, I don't.
I intended to spend like 8 minutes on this thing, but I didn't realize that it would end up being polarizing. I guess I should have known in 2024 every story, even one that would seem to be kind of slam dunkish. would somehow be polarizing. So here's the other thing that surprised, and this is also what surprises me. I like to think that, especially given the numbers of kids who face OCD, that it no longer, the old stigma that sadly has been attached to it would already be eroding because so many other kids have been diagnosed with it or are being treated for it at various levels, various stages, etc. So that's the other, look at the statistics of the number of kids in school who are diagnosed with OCD, and I'm thinking, well, is that different at that school where suddenly that's something that's so odd and so worth demonizing when there's a lot more public discussion about it, a lot more honesty about it, and any number of students, the idea that, well, that makes you some sort of an outlier? I would think even at that school, that what do we say, Crosby Ironton?
Mm-hmm.
How many, what's enrollment at Crosby Ironton? Any clue?
I have no idea. I can take a look for you.
I'm an educator for 24 years, writes 320 guy. Man, they're pouring in. There are more and more students you cannot discipline. There are more and more parents that would go to their grave for their child. So I guess the message there being what we've talked about before.
Not my kid.
My kid would never do that. And you're going to do what? No. You don't have the right to do that to my kid. We hear that. We quoted Jamal Crawford on that very subject as it pertains to AAU basketball. We broadened it out well beyond AAU basketball, bringing it back, ironically, to education as well. That is a massive difficulty that many teachers have told us is making their job more and more daunting, and administrators making their job more and more daunting. And again, this isn't all parents, but it feels like the percentage of parents is going up dramatically. The inability to, again, it's gonna sound back in my day, but most of us, when we got in any kind of difficulty at school, the assumption was, God, wait till mom or dad finds out about this, right? And were they incapable of standing up for their kid if they thought their kid had not done anything wrong? No. But when they were convinced that their kid had done something wrong, I think you'd like to believe that the position of most parents, if you're going to get anything done satisfactorily in this regard, is throw the book at them. Or no, he or she's got to learn. And the administrators are telling us that that's happening far less often. Top of the hour pause. We'll get to, I think when we come back, what I intended to get to through much of that segment, which is another very controversial subject, which I think is going to interest Guardsy as well. Stay